I have a question for you. What's one of the most important but difficult things that scientists do? I would say it's science communication. In other words, sharing the interesting discoveries that we've made in ways that are accurate, easy to understand, and engaging. But here's the problem. We scientists often don't do a very good job of part of this, because most of us aren't trained in science communication. And that can limit the impact of our research. To improve my ability to share my research, about 10 years ago, I started reading books and articles about science communication and writing. Here's a cartoon that I love from one of those articles. It shows that bad habits in science communication are often passed from one generation to the next. And unfortunately, sometimes the journals where we publish our research are part of the problem. That's what I learned this past year as I struggled to publish an article in a well-respected agricultural journal about a mistake that I and many other researchers have made. In my confessional article, I told the story of how I discovered my mistake, and I suggested ways to correct it. But some editors in that journal, where I submitted that confessional article, didn't like that I used the first-person pronoun I to refer to myself. And they rejected my paper more than once until I reluctantly replaced the first-person pronoun I with the author. I was shocked and frustrated because that change went against everything that I'd learned about effective science communication. Referring to myself as the author made many sentences in my paper more difficult to read, and it put this unnecessary and distracting obstacle between me and my readers. I didn't want to become the author. Here's a cartoon that I drew to show that struggle. It's pretty clear that I is much more popular, engaging, nimble, and active than the author. So what's wrong with using the first-person voice in science writing? Nothing. It's actually a more clear, concise, and engaging way to write. Let me prove that with an example from the opening sentence that I wrote in a science communication article I published a few years ago. Let's start with the first-person version. When I go camping with my family, I often joke that our oatmeal smells like bacon. Now for the third-person version. When the present author goes camping with his family, he often jokes that his family's oatmeal smells like bacon. Oh, you get my point. The first-person version is shorter and has a 29% higher readability score. And I think that most readers would find that first-person version to be easier to read and more likely to hook and hold their attention. So why didn't the editors let me use the first-person voice in my confessional paper? I never got a good explanation, but I assume that it's based on this outdated notion that the first-person voice is somehow less scientific and less objective than the third-person voice. But that old way of thinking has been soundly rejected by authors of well-respected books on science writing. For example, decades ago, Robert Day called on young scientists to renounce the false modesty of previous generations and not be afraid to name the agent of action, even when it's I or we. And then about 10 years ago, Helen Sword said that when we muzzle our personal voice, we risk subverting our whole purpose as researchers, which is to foster change by communicating new knowledge in the most effective and persuasive way possible. Furthermore, some of the most widely used publication and style manuals in the world tell authors to use the first-person voice. But as my experience shows, writing in the first-person voice can still lead to rejection of a paper in some journals. But here's the good news. Things are changing, even in the journal where my struggle occurred. Now, before I tell you about those changes and propose a way forward, let me give you a quick voice lesson. Do, re, mi. I don't mean that kind of a voice lesson. Rather, what I mean is a first-person voice lesson, just to make sure that you understand that there's different types of first-person voice. Okay, so the first-person voice can be singular, if you're the sole author of a paper, where you'd use the first-person pronouns I and my. but it can also be plural if you have co-authors where you'd use the pronouns we and our. Okay, so now let's look at some encouraging data on changes in voice in science writing. Here's a graph of how the voice that agricultural scientists have used in articles has changed radically over the past 100 years. It's based on data that I collected from articles in the journal where I struggled to publish my confessional paper. And it clearly shows an increase in the use of the first-person voice in articles. Now, I acknowledge that most of these articles had multiple authors, and therefore, they use the first-person plural pronouns, we and our. But here's the thing. It's irrational and unfair for editors to allow the first-person plural voice, but not allow the first-person singular voice. Now, I think that this bias against the first-person singular voice that I experienced might be because today relatively few single-authored science papers are published. And therefore, some readers, editors, and authors are uncomfortable with the first-person singular voice. But that doesn't mean there's anything wrong with it. So to address the bias against the first-person voice in the journal where my struggle occurred, I suggest the following addition to the publication's handbook and style manual for that journal. It's a style manual for more than 10 other important agricultural journals also. My suggestions highlight the value of the first-person voice and clarify that authors should use a writing style that they believe will best communicate their message and connect with readers. What do you think about this? I hope you'll join me to improve science communication and support the use of the first-person voice in science writing. Thanks for listening, and take care.